So calibration, what do you mean by calibration? Suppose 10 units of sample is present. The signal given by the machine should be according to that 10 units. Okay. So to calibrate this, the known quantity of analyte should be added to the machine and the signal should be adjusted according to that. That means the internal standard or the sample similar with similar properties. Suppose you are analyzing, say, cadmium, you are analyzing, or you are analyzing iron. So a sample containing known quantity of iron should be introduced in the machine. This spark ablation should be carried out and the signal should be in proportion to the sample we had taken before. Okay. If the signal is less, the calibration should be done so that it is giving the higher the proportionate signal and vice versa. Okay. This was in case of spark ablation. Now, second is laser ablation. Now, laser ablation, it is a microchemical sampling procedure. What do you mean by micro? That means very small quantity of sample from the entire pool of the sample is taken. Now, this is taken by bombarding laser to a very focused area of the sample. Okay. Now, which type of laser is used? A pulsed neodymium, neodymium, yttrium, aluminum, garnet, that is NDYAG laser is used. Garnet is nothing but a mineral stone. That means in that mineral stone, you have these all the elements. Okay. Neodymium, yttrium, and aluminum. The salts, generally silicates of these three are present in the in that particular stone and laser is produced from that stone. Okay. This high energy laser pulse, when it is bombarded repetitively, more and more sample will get converted into aerosol. So it will increase the precision and accuracy. How it is increasing precision accuracy? Just because you have more sample in the aerosol now. That's why precision accuracy is increasing. Refractory materials, geological samples can be analyzed for trace elements and major elements also with this technique. If the sample is powdered sample, it will pose a challenge. Okay. So powder will be first converted into pellets by applying high pressure and then this technique can be used. Now, we move to now to the plasma source. There are two main types of plasma sources: inductively coupled plasma source and direct current plasma source. Now, inductively coupled means induction. The phenomena of induction is used and plasma is produced. In direct current, the current is applied to produce the plasma. Okay, so this is the basic difference between these two techniques. Okay. The term plasma is defined as homogeneous mixture of gaseous atoms, ions, and electrons at very high temperature. Two types of plasma atomic emission sources are frequently used: inductively coupled plasma and direct coupled plasma. We'll first start with the inductively coupled plasma. I hope you can see three photographs over here. The first is actual photograph of inductively coupled plasma source. This is also called as plasma torch. It is also called as inductively coupled plasma torch. These two are schematic representations. These two are schematic representation of the same thing. Okay. You can see the labeling also, I think. Now, the illustration over here provides a schematic diagram of inductively coupled plasma sources. It consists of three concentric quad tubes at the top provided with a radio frequency coil. It is also called as induction coil. It is also called as Tesla coil. So it is basically, these are three quartz tubes. Okay. Quartz means they are transparent in UV region as well as they are transparent in the visible region. Now, when I'm saying concentric, I hope you understand the word concentric. Can you see this blue colored tube? This is the outermost jacket. Again, made up of quartz only. Then inside it, you have a green color tube. And inside that green color, you have a white color tube. All three tubes are made up of quartz only. Okay. Now, the sample is mixed with a stream of argon using nebulizer and carried to the plasma over here through the central capillary. So that aerosol produced, we have seen how the sample is prepared. So that aerosol produced will be carried to the plasma through this central tube. Okay, the central tube is also seen over here. So from central tube, you are carrying your sample to the plasma. Okay, in the next step, plasma formation is initiated by a spark from a Tesla coil. This yellow color Tesla coil here or white color Tesla coil here, both are responsible for the producing the plasma in this area, the spark in this area. Okay, what happens is the alternating current of very high radio frequency is flowing through this induction coil. Okay, frequency means you understand alternating current, that at one instant one end is positive, at the other instant, the next instant, the same end is negative. Okay, so this alternation between positive and negative current, positive and negative end, is happening with very high frequency, radio frequency. Okay, now when electricity is flowing through the coil, a magnetic field is associated with it. Now when this coil is altering in its current, the induction produced or induced magnetic field produced between it will also fluctuate with very high frequency. Okay, now it will cause generation of heat over here. Now in this, argon gas is also present. Okay, from this green tube, okay, argon gas is introduced over here. Okay, see, this argon gas is coming here. So basically, argon gas is trapped in this fluctuating magnetic field. Okay, the fluctuating magnetic field is produced because of the alternating current, which is changing at radio frequency. So argon is in a way gets trapped into it. Okay, it induces formation of argon ions. Argon will lose its electron. So you have a cloud over here, which is trapped, consisting of argon atoms, electrons, and ions of argon. Okay, but since the magnetic field is fluctuating very fast, all those ions, atoms, and electrons will start moving in circular manner. And because of the high frequency of the change in the magnetic field, the speed with which they are moving in circular manner is very high. This causes production of spark. This causes production of plasma. Why plasma is forming? See, I will tell the events again. This is Tesla coil here, induction coil here. Okay. What is the role of induction coil? It will generate plasma. How it generates plasma? Its current flowing through the Tesla coil, the induction coil, is altering very fast with very high frequency. The frequency, how high it is? It is as good as the radio frequency, megahertz, few megahertz. Okay, it is altering with that high frequency. So when it is altering with that high frequency, the magnetic field associated with that coil is also fluctuating. Now, this fluctuating magnetic field will cause loss of electron for argon. Okay, so there is argon ion, there are electrons, and fresh argon gas coming from here. So all of it is in a way trapped over here because of the fluctuating magnetic field. Because of the collisions of ions, atoms, and electrons, the temperature increases, it causes spark, and it causes generation of plasma. I hope you understood this. Now, the resulting collisions with the abundant ionized gas give rise to resistive heating, providing temperature as high as 10,000 kelvins. Now 10,000 kelvin is very high temperature. Okay, that temperature is produced over here. You can see the labeling, 10,000 kelvin in this area. Okay, 10,000 kelvin at the base of the plasma and between 6,000 to 8,000 at the height 15 to 20 millimeters above the coil. So see, the pressurized argon gas is pumped from here. This is area of heating. So when gas is coming out of here, the gas is still heated and you get a torch over here and the temperature is 10,000, 8,000 up to 6,000 kelvin. Okay, so very high temperature. This height over here is approximately 15 to 20 millimeters. This is the starting height of plasma. This is the level at which the plasma is generated and plasma extends till this point. Now at this high temperature, the outer quartz tube, see, this is very high temperature over here. So this outer tube and inner tubes, they are getting heated. So they needs to be cooled. So for that, a tangential flow of argon gas, tangential means the argon will come enter here and it will spirally move upwards. Okay, that argon is under pressure and it is cooled. What is the role of this tangentially flowing argon? Cooling down the tubes. Okay, we are not cooling down the plasma. Plasma will not cool down, but the quartz should not melt. Quartz should not get damaged. So we are using that argon which is flowing. Now you must have noticed there is argon mixed with the sample in the central tube. There is argon coming from the middle tube. There is argon flowing from the outermost jacket tube also. So we are requiring lots and lots of argon. So this particular plasma source, inductively coupled plasma, utilizes large quantity of argon. Now a typical inductively coupled plasma consists of again three concentric quartz tube through which stream of argon gas flow at the rate in the range of 5 liter to 20 liter per minute. I repeat, the overall flow rate of argon from these tiny tubes is 5 liter to 20 liter per minute. This is very high flow rate. 5 liter in a minute. Can you imagine how fast it must be flowing? At your home, the bucket is not filled in a minute. 5 liter bucket cannot be filled in a minute with water, with your tap water. Okay, and with very high pressure, the argon is flowing through this. So you can imagine how high is the flow rate. Okay, and how large quantity of argon is required. The outermost tube is about 2.5 centimeters in diameter. Okay, someone is asking a doubt. How is the argon gas going up to the area of Tesla coil? Isn't the plasma closed tube? No, it is open tube. Plasma at the top is open. See, this is open tube at the top. So under pressure, all the argons are from all the tubes. The argon is flowing under pressure. So although the plasma is created, this turbulence is created over here, still there is net outflow of the argon gas. Okay. So I was telling about the outer diameter of the outermost tube. Okay. It is almost 2.5 centimeters in the diameter. And the top of this tube is surrounded by this radio frequency powered induction coil. Induction coil produces a power of 2 kilowatt at a frequency in the range of 27 megahertz to 41 megahertz. Now 2 kilowatts is again very high energy. Okay, and 27 to 41 megahertz is very high frequency. So this coil produces a strong magnetic field as well, which is fluctuating. Now, I hope you can see that orange color circle over here. I am pointing out this coil area at the top of the tube. Okay, Ionization of the flowing argon is achieved by spark, where ionized argon interacts with a strong magnetic field and thus is forced to move within the vicinity in the induced coil at very high speed. So it is argon is moving with very high speed over here. Now it is not just argon, it is argon ions also and electrons also. A very high temperature is obtained as a result of very high resistance experienced by the circulating argon. Now, why argon is experiencing the resistance? Because see, the magnetic field is fluctuating. So those ions and electrons, they although circulating in a, you can say, circular path, but their path will not be exactly circular. They will be spiraling. Okay, they will be spiraling. So they will be moving in this manner. So they will collide with argon and argon ion. So basically there will be lots of collisions, and this collision will cause increase in the temperature. So this top will get heated. I am repeating the points. So when these tops get heated, you will require a coolant. Okay, the coolant here used as argon gas only, which is introduced tangentially, which is flowing tangentially, and that is cooling down everything. Okay, so once you know how the plasma is produced, this is how that plasma actually looks like. Okay, every line here is indicating that the sample aerosol, when introduced in the plasma, is flowing with high velocity. Okay, it is heated at very high temperature. Now please observe all parts of the diagram. On left hand side, there is a scale in millimeters. This is where the plasma is produced. This distance is almost 15 millimeter. This is 20 millimeter. This is 25 millimeter. At this site, the temperature is 6000. At this site, approximately 20 millimeter, temperature is 6200,000 Kelvin. Below that, almost at 15 millimeter, it is 6500 Kelvin. In this region only, the measurement is taken. Now, when I'm saying measurement is taken, I mean to say the electromagnetic radiation will pass through this region. Okay, I hope it is clear. Now, even if it is emission, it is used for emission, the radiation coming from this region, the radiation, when I'm saying the radiation, that means sample will be introduced, the sample will get atomized, and those atoms will give out energy, the photon, characteristic photon, because of the high temperature over here. So the electromagnetic radiation coming out of this region will be measured. The reason for using argon gas is very important. Argon is a unique inert gas for plasma torches. It has very few emission lines, and those emission lines are easily distinguishable. So it is not basically interfering with the signal of your analyte. Okay, this decreases the possibility of interference with other analytes also. Okay, ionization in plasma may be thought to be problem due to very high temperature, but fortunately the large electron flux from the ionization of argon will suppress the ionization of all species. It will cause more and more ionization of argon only. See, in other words, you can say there is lot of argon and very few quantity of the element. Okay, so if ionization has to occur, it will preferably occur to argon because it is present in more quantity, and ionization of your sample will occur at few instances. I'm not saying it will not occur at all, but it will occur at very few instances. So this was inductively coupled plasma. This is actually how it looks like. You can see the initial part is not transparent, then it becomes transparent. See, this part is again transparent. This is not transparent. So plasma torch or the inductively coupled plasma looks very much like a flame. It is almost like a flame only, but it is very intense than flame, and it is also non-transparent, very brilliant white in color. Okay, it is white. It is not yellow colored flame. It is white colored flame. Now, if you will observe, at immediately from the point where plasma is starting, it is not at all, not at all transparent. So, if it is not transparent, can you use it for atomic absorption spectroscopy? Think about it. If it is not transparent, can you use for atomic absorption spectroscopy? If you will see the temperature of the plasma, it is almost 100 to 1000 times that of the normal flame. So it is very high in temperature. So these plasmas, they are very efficient in producing the spectra. And there will be very few number of chemical interferences. I have asked you a question regarding whether you can use this for atomic absorption spectroscopy. Think about it. As you are thinking, I will explain you the next type of plasma, direct current plasma, short form DCP. On the left-hand side, you have actual photograph of direct current plasma. On the right-hand side, you have schematic representation. You can go through the diagram. Okay, better you go through this schematic diagram. You will observe that there are three electrodes. This is one electrode. This is made up of tungsten. This is tungsten electrode. And there are two more electrodes. Both of these electrodes are made up of graphite. They are arranged in a manner that it will look like inverted Y. It looks like inverted Y. Okay. So these two are the, you can say, two arms of the inverted Y. And this is the tungsten electrode. Now, through these two graphite electrodes made of graphite, argon gas is flowing. And there is high voltage applied between two electrodes. Okay, this tungsten electrode will come in contact with these two electrodes. It will lower itself and it will come in contact with these two electrodes. And because there is large potential difference between them, a spark is generated and the argon flowing through these graphite electrode will turn into plasma. Okay, the moment the tungsten electrode touches this particular graphite electrodes, the argon will get ionized because the spark is generated there. Okay, and that it will cause, you can say, a chain reaction that every next atom coming from here, it will acquire that ionization, and the ionized plasma will be flowing from this electrode to this electrode. Okay, so this plasma is through, you can say, flowing with very high energy between these two electrodes. It is the current which ionizes more and more argon. See, between the electrodes, current is flowing. So it is that current which is ionizing more and more argons, and it is sustaining this plasma indefinitely till the current is stopping. Till you switch off the current, the plasma will continue flow. Okay, now sample in the form of aerosol will be introduced over here, where two plasma from two electrodes are joining. Okay, at the junction, at the center of this Y, the plasma will be introduced. The temperature over here is 5000 degrees Celsius. So temperature over here is comparatively less. Okay, inductively coupled plasma source, we had very high temperature. Here the temperature is comparatively less. Now this direct current plasma sources usually have fewer lines as compared to inductively current plasma sources. The reason? Temperature is low, so energy is low, so excitation of the analyte atoms will be less. If the excitation is less, it is producing lesser lines, less number of lines. Okay, but the drawback is it is also less sensitive. It is also less sensitive. In addition, the graphite electrodes, these two graphite electrodes, they are getting heated with this plasma. So as the time progresses, they go on decaying. So you need to change them over a period of time. They have their life. When life is over, you need to change them. So it is costly. Okay, they need frequent changing. So this is comparison between ICP and DCP. Advantages of direct current plasma: that less argon gas is consumed. This consumes very less argon gas. The instrumentation is simpler. No Tesla coil, no three concentric tubes. So instrumentation is very simple. Less spectral line interference. Now, disadvantages of direct current plasma is anodes are frequently changed. It is also less sensitive. Now, advantages of inductively coupled plasma: it is convenient to work with. Although the construction is complicated, working with the inductively coupled plasma source is very convenient. Okay. It is free from frequent consumable. The exception is argon gas. Okay. And it is far more sensitive as compared to DCP. Okay, these are the advantages of the plasma sources overall. Now, no oxide formation as a result of two factors, including very high temperature and second, inert environment inside the plasma. So when we are saying very high temperature, we are providing environment to the analyte so that the atomization process has sufficient energy to convert molecules into atom. It is not giving you the side reaction of oxidation. That's why the very high temperature is useful over here. Second, we are using argon. There is no oxygen there. Okay. So both of these factors contributing in no oxidation formation. Second, minimal chemical interferences. When there is no side reaction, there will be no chemical interferences. Now, this term of chemical interference, it is coming for the second time today. Okay. This chemical interference is important chapter, important point in this chapter. We are going to study it. Okay. Chemical interferences, it is asked for 2 or 3 marks. We are going to study it separately. For timing, you remember, there are no chemical side reaction, that's why minimal chemical interferences are there. Now, minimal spectral interferences. Spectral interferences means spectra coming from unwanted sources, say from argon, from the carrier gas if it is used, if it is oxidant, in case of flame, oxidants are used. So there are lines because of that also. So spectral interferences are also less. Uniform temperature, which results in precise determinations. Now imagine there is a plasma source or there is some source whose temperature is fluctuating. So in one instant you have 100 atoms in the flame, in the next instant you have 50 atoms in the flame, but the flow of rate of the sample coming into the flame is constant. So what a person or what will be the detector measuring? That the concentration of the sample is fluctuating. Okay, so if temperature is maintained, the atomization process and the signaling process, that is signal coming from the atom, is constant. Okay, so uniform temperature results in precise determination. So precision is there. No self-absorption is observed, which extends the linear dynamic range of the concentration. Now, if you remember the limitations of Beer's law, if there is self-absorption, this gets declined. Okay, because there is interference by the same species. Okay, So self absorption is avoided because of the high temperature. So if most of the atoms they are at excited state, they will not absorb photon because they are already excited. Only when it is at the ground, so it can absorb photon. Okay. No need for a separate lamp for each element. Easily adaptable for multi-channel analysis. So these are all the advantages. Now, these were the plasma sources. Now we will move on and quickly finish off the flame atomizers and then we will stop. There are two types, main types of flame atomizers. हमने अभी क्या देखा? Plasma sources. Now we are looking at the flame sources. I think someone has a doubt. I will read that doubt. But the temperature was different at different point in a range. Okay, Minal has asked a doubt. I will show the PPT what she is asking. Okay, she is saying that at different slits, we will determine from which area we want to take the reading. So, for example, if I adjust slit to this area, I am focusing on the signal coming from the temperature range of 60 to 100 only. Okay. So I am not concerned with this area. I am not concerned with this area. I am concerned only atoms in this region. Okay. I hope your doubt is clear, Minal. Okay. Flame atomizers. The first type of flame atomizer is turbulent flow or total combustion burner. You observe this diagram, you will understand what it is. There are only three parts in this particular atomizer, flame atomizer. Basically, the burner and nebulizer is the same thing. So nebulization is occurring at this point. And the same point you are igniting it. So yahan pe hi aapko flame bhi milega. Okay. Now from the central tube, the sample is introduced. From here you have got oxidizer gas, oxidizer inlet, and the outermost is fuel inlet. Now oxidizer can be your oxygen. It can be your air. Fuel can be your liquefied petroleum gas, it can be your natural gas, it can be your acetylene, and depending on the analyte, you can choose what fuel you are going to use. So in total combustion burner, the fuel, the oxidant and the sample, they are going to all meet at this one point where the flame is producing. Okay. Now, I'm sorry. The fuel, generally acetylene is used, but any other fuel, depending on the analyte, can be used. Generally acetylene is used, remember. And oxidant generally used is normal air, compressed air. Okay. No special oxygen cylinder is required over here. Okay. So they are forced, they are compressed, and under pressure they come over here. Okay. See, all the time sample will not be present, but oxidizer and fuel will be always be present. So you will get a flame over here. Now, when flame is producing, in a way, momentarily, there will be sessions of generation of vacuum at this point. Okay. Because, see, oxidizer is coming. So some volume is coming over here. Some fuel is also coming, say acetylene and oxygen. They both are combining and forming a plasma, forming a flame. So basically a volume is, you can say, is getting vanished. So vacuum is created over here. This vacuum will draw the sample from its container till the flame. Okay. So there is no separate pump is required for pumping sample into the flame. It is getting sucked automatically. This type of burner used in flame photometry and is not much useful in atomic absorption spectroscopy. Now the reason is, you can say the reason for this is the resulting flame is turbulent. It is not a steady flame, as you were getting the steady flame in case of plasma. So it is turbulent flame. It is also non-homogeneous. So for atomic absorption, it is not useful. For atomic absorption, those plasmas are useful, not this one. Since the flame must be homogeneous for the atomic absorption, different sample covets in molecular spectroscopy must be closely matched. For different sample, the burner shape should be changed. Okay. See, I will tell you, suppose your sample is combustible. Okay. So it may cause very small blast over here. So for that, the opening for the sample should be smaller. So at a time, very small quantity of sample is introduced. If your sample is not properly combustible, so you require wide opening. So this burner should be different over here. Okay, so for different sample, different properties of sample, you require different burner, different type of opening. I think this construction is very simple. If you have doubt, you can ask in the chat section. Okay, so let us move on to advantages and disadvantages. Advantages, design is very simple. Entire sample is getting consumed. So large quantity of sample is present in the flame. Okay, disadvantages. Uniform and homogeneous flame is not obtained. We discussed this. Since droplet size are varying, this fluctuation is also there. See, in most of the cases, the droplets that we produce, we used baffles to isolate the larger droplets. But here, the entire sample is introduced in the flame. So all large samples, small droplets, are everything is in this flame. So signal coming from this is not uniform. This is the second type. Second type, its name is pre-mixed burner or laminar flow burner. You must have studied what is laminar flow. Observe the diagram. You will immediately observe some difference between the total combustion burner and premix burner. Observe the diagram. Okay. Now, from here, fuel is coming into the chamber. This is laminar flow chamber. Okay. The fuel is entering in the chamber. Then oxidant is also entering the chamber. Then there is aspirator air over here. See, this was not present in previous type. This is normal compressed air. Because of this compressed air, when sample is sucked in, a nebula is formed, a cloud is formed. This cloud of small droplets will be mixed with the oxidant gas. It will be mixed with the fuel gas. Now there are mixing baffles. They are rotating. Okay. They are rotating and there are some fixed baffles. Okay. What is the work of these baffles? First, mixing and separating large droplets. So those large droplets will form a drain which come out from here. Okay. Now, so when the uniform cloud of the fuel oxidant and the sample, it is reaching to the burner, you are getting a flame over here. Ignition should be provided. This is called as pre-mix burner or laminar flow burner. What are its advantages? The flame produced is very stable, no turbulent, and it is also noiseless. The previous burner was noisy. This is noiseless. See, second advantage, vaporization, atomization, and excitation of atoms takes place very efficiently. Third, it is sensitive. The result produced are reproducible. Disadvantages, only small proportion of the sample reaches to the flame. Okay, very small quantity of the sample is reaching to the flame. Okay, second disadvantage, due to large wastage, fewer atoms are excited and constantly the emission intensity is weak. This is serious disadvantage. that the intensity of the signal coming from this burner is less. Third, this lowers the sensitivity of the estimation. If the intensity of the electromagnetic radiation is less, obviously the sensitivity of this technique is also less. Okay. I have given you one demo of the burner flame photometry in our lab. So it was a pre-mixed laminar flow burner. I think only 4 minutes are left in the today's lecture. I will stop here. The question asked by Meenal is the cooling technique you told about that inductively coupled plasma. She did not understood it. See, you can compare that inductively coupled plasma with your condenser. See, this is the inside of your condenser and this is outer jacket of your condenser. Inside, the fumes are getting refluxed. Okay, I am using the analogy. Okay, so inside the temperature is very hot. Okay, here it is the hottest part. This area is the hottest part. You need to cool it down. If you directly introduce something cooling agent over here, it will break. Like if you put hot glass in water, it breaks. So you cannot directly introduce a coolant over here. So what you are doing is you are introducing argon from here. See, it is flowing tangentially, means automatically it is spiraling. This is the flow of argon and this is flow tangential to that flow. So that's why it is called as tangential argon plasma support flow. Okay, this direction is tangential. This is the actual direction. This direction is tangential direction. So it is coming from here and it is spiraling upwards and then coming out of here. Does that solve your doubt, Meenal? Okay, good. Yes, Aditi. Sir, you have asked one question during the lecture. Yes. Whether plasma source can be used for atomic absorption. Okay, almost everybody left. Still, I will answer this. Atomic absorption, it for plasma source, it can be used, but you have to select height from the flame according to that, the area where it is transparent for that electromagnetic radiation, then only it can be used. Okay, I will repeat this question again in the next class. I forgot to explain. Okay, you can leave.